to order at 6:20 for Frontier Regional School Committee of this joint school committee part. So we're going to approve the minutes of August 4th, 2016.
So moved.
For Frontier, I need a motion. Thank you, Bob. I need a second. Okay, hopefully you've had a chance to look them over. Any questions, discussion?
Nope.
All those in favor? Anyone Campo? Who is not here at the joint meeting? Okay, unanimous.
We'll call the meeting to order of the Union 38 School Committee at 6:20. And entertain a motion from Don Skrasky.
So moved.
Approve the minutes. And a second by
Brian
Holler.
Say it.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion? All in favor? It's opposed. One opposed?
No.
Oh, in favor?
She was still counting.
Oh, okay. So it was unanimous.
Public comment? No unfinished business. On to new business. Technology updates. We have Scott Paul.
Good evening.
Welcome.
Thank you. So I'll just take a couple minutes just to describe where we are at and the projects we've been working on, and again, kind of our outlook into this year. We've done a lot more infrastructure work over the last couple months. We have replaced the entire network for all the schools through a digital connections partnership grant. So we had a lot of money. The project was about $150,000. And so that grant, we were semi-finalists for it. We were approved, and we went through the summer installing that equipment. What it does for the schools, it basically has a little better internet connectivity throughout the schools, as well as we increase the wireless capacity for more devices and newer access points. In some schools like Whately, we actually replaced the entire wireless infrastructure, so that was good, it was needed. So we're looking pretty good as far as infrastructure. The other big project this summer was a transition to the new student information system, PowerSchool. And hopefully those that have our parents have received their parent letter from grades 7 through 12. Those parent portals are active. The student portals are also active for those grades. And you can go on and see the students' grades and assignments that the teachers publishing. And it's a new grade book for the teachers. It's a new admin platform for all the schools. All five schools are in one system, basically, so I think the efficiency is going to be great going into the future rather than five separate systems. We have one data specialist, DJ Coons, who's been working tirelessly over the summer to transition the data from an older system into this new system. So we're getting things done, and it's looking pretty good. The gradebook is a brand new version, even from the company, so we're working through that. We've done a lot of training out there. We have done three-day training for the admin. We did one day for the teachers. We had some other group training. And we're also doing one-to-one training to help the teachers through this transition. So things, I think, are running pretty smoothly. We're into that state reporting season as well, which that's different for us as well. Along with that, it sets off a chain reaction. We have increased or changed our notification system. We had Blackboard Connect, now it's School Messenger. And that information flows from our PowerSchool to that system. So no longer do we have to have someone sitting with a spreadsheet managing all phone numbers for all parents. It's done through PowerSchool, and then it's pushed out to that notification system. It's cheaper, it's easier to use, they have better support, and we decided to go with that. And we're linking this PowerSchool system with many other systems. Some of them are done, some of them are still to be done. The nursing program called SNAP, we moved that from Redeker's hosting service to our internal servers and got that up and operational. And we combined all five schools again into one system, seen as five schools still, but it's at least standardized. And so the nurses from one school to another see the exact same thing, so they can talk the same language. Again, it's uniform, which is really nice. And that system's also being updated from information from PowerSchool. So there's a few more systems out there that we have to change over. Fall of Destiny, the library system. We're going to be changing over the eSped, which is a special education system, and Meals Plus, which is a cafeteria system. So there's still some more work on that infrastructure, but for the most part, we're looking really good with that. We will be piloting K through 6 online gradebooks and that's going to occur over this year, standards-based. We have to set that up on PowerSchool, and we'll have a handful of teachers helping us through, seeing what they think of the grade book, and also what it would look like as a report card going to the parents. Those are the big ones. We've done actually piloting right now one-to-one at 7th and 8th grade at Frontier with Chromebooks. And the other big project, we've been moving a lot of stuff. We've been moving labs around the schools to accommodate for the central office move. And so our computer science lab is now up in A222 and A110. So that's basically what's going on. Any questions?
How did we get the grant?
We got the grant,
did you see it and then write it?
I filled out all the paperwork, wrote it. We had to submit, you know, our statistics for the district, how many devices we have, how many students we have, our current needs. And our network at the time was over 10 years old, so all the switches were in dire need of being replaced. So I think based on need and student population and everything, we were semi-finalists and had enough money from the finalists to push down to us, and we were able to fund it.
Who's the grant from, Scott?
Where was the grant from? Yeah. It was from the state. So it's Mass IT to go that arena.
Congratulations. That's awesome.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yes. Yeah. A lot of money.
That's terrific. And just from a parent's point of view, PowerSchool, I love it. I don't know. I hope it's all good. Hope it's as good for you as it is for me. And
it doesn't take much to make you happy, Phil.
You're just a happy kind of guy.
There you go.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Steve. Okay, I noticed that the same two people are doing the MCAS and the professional development updates, so I'll let you kind of take it away and do it any way you want. Louise Law and Sarah Mitchell.
Okay. I'm going to distribute. We thought we would start, the future of MCAS, what's happening this year, and what the plans are, because it's all changing. This year, the state is moving toward testing, online testing. The requirement for every fourth and eighth grader throughout the state is to take it online. The state offered the option if schools would opt in to participating online in other grades, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8, that we would get a held harmless year, which means that regardless of how students do on the test, we wouldn't be going down a level to like level 3. So it's kind of a freebie year because they want us to try out how it works with our infrastructure, how students will work online. So we took that option for a number of reasons. First of all, we want students to have the experience and give us feedback in a year it doesn't count. So it's a low stress participation for teachers because they don't have to worry if low scores will bring us down a level. It's a hold harmless year. And it will give us an opportunity to try out if our infrastructure can tolerate simultaneous testing, and how students do taking a test on a computer, particularly in the elementary schools. So it's kind of a practice year. And as a dry run, we're bringing in additional Chromebooks. I was just talking to Scott about it. We're ordering enough Chromebooks so that in each school, an entire grade level can test simultaneously. Because there are three sessions of English language arts and 2 sessions of math, if we didn't have testing on laptops or Chromebooks in classrooms, we would have to shut the lab down for 8 weeks. Students would have no access to computers. We would take every computer in the school, in some of our schools. So we're trying to figure out a process where we can offer a balance of some students participating on Chromebooks or laptops and some of the younger students on the desktops because they're bigger. So that is the shift at the state level. This is the first year coming up of what they are calling MCAS 2.0. What that means is they have looked at PARC. Originally, PARC was what we were going to have. And then some folks in the state raised objections. And the state listened and said, okay, we're going to bring a team of educators together and you're going to look at PARC, you're going to look at old MCAS, and create, use what they say, the best of both. So they're creating an amalgam kind of test. We don't know what it will look like. We're guessing what it will look like, and that's why we thought this first time out, we could do it without the pressure of worrying, frankly, about how students do. We're trying it out. We're going to ask students to give us feedback, what worked, what didn't work, what was hard for you. So that's our plan, is we are going live with this. It will begin April 3rd in the whole state and go till May 26th. That's the longest window they've ever given us because the state is very aware of the fact that the capacity to administer tests online is going to be limited by the number of devices in a particular school. So that's our plan moving forward, is to shift gradually into this online by doing this first year when it's low pressure for everybody.
So Louise got to do the exciting step forward into the future, and I'm going to do the step backward into the past and show you MCAS scores from last year. So I gave you each a colored sheet that has just your school on it, and I'm just going to give you the broad brushstrokes of what each of these boxes means. One thing we have to keep in mind is about a quarter to a third of the state took MCAS this year, so they're not putting out a lot of the state data that they have traditionally put out so that we could do some real comparisons. And frankly, that's really the only way to use your MCAS data is to do state comparisons, because the test is easier or harder depending on what grade level you're talking about. So if you look at box one, it's just the general information about what the school is. And this is the one that has the three square boxes on it. That's the side that I'm on. So box one is just general geographic information about the school. Box two tells the level. So in our district, all of our schools are either level one or level two. Level one means that we're meeting the target. Level two means that we're not meeting the target, or there are gaps between high-need students and the general school population. So it's a very complicated formula to calculate that. Basically, the state has set 75 as the target for all schools, and they're using the last 4 years' worth of MCAS data. They give you points for your growth, they give you points for how many students you have proficient, graduation rate, dropout rate, and they use seven indicators. They apply a formula to it, and that's how you're getting that number that's in box three, actually. So if you look down on the right, you can see a bunch of numbers. Some of you will have numbers next to, for example, high needs students, you'll have numbers, and other schools are so small that there just isn't a large enough population to count that piece. And that's why some of you have numbers on there and some of you don't. But bouncing back to box two, sorry, I skipped this part, you also see that number that's a percentile, and that's how the school is compared to other like schools in the state. It's a bit of a tricky number. There tends to be enough elementary schools for some kind of comparison. At the middle high school for Frontier, it's really only comparing us with about 14 or so schools, so it's kind of a hard number to interpret. So we take that with a grain of salt as we do our analysis of the information. If you flip over, oh, sorry, go ahead.
Is it defined what they use for like school?
Yes, so for elementary schools, they use anybody that's K through 5 or K through 6. For middle schools, they use 6 through 8. That's not going to apply to us. And for Frontier, they use any school that's 7 through 12. So there's about 14 schools in the state that are 7 through 12. Half of them are charter schools. So it's really hard to get an accurate read on that number.
That took MCAS.
Only about half of those took MCAS.
Right, this one's MCAS.
Yeah.
But it's not.
Could I add, it's not demographic.
It's not grouping.
Not demographic.
Correct. Yeah. So it's hard. It's a really hard number to interpret. And what we've done is we've teased out at Frontier, particularly the elementary schools, at least there's enough elementary schools in Massachusetts so you can kind of get a sense of that. But at the middle high school level, what we do is we've actually pulled down all the data from all those other schools to look and see what it looks like to try and find another school that's demographically like us.
And please hit add. Yep. Yes, and in our district, because we're at K-6, it is a slightly smaller cohort because most elementary schools these days are K-5, so they're comparing us to other K-6 schools, regardless of demographics. This year, it was about between a quarter and a third that took it, and it tended to be the higher achieving schools that could opt out of PARC. So the demographic we're compared to is not the same cohort that for years and years we're compared to. And that's what makes it challenging.
It's a challenging year to interpret. But next year we'll all be on the same page again, and we can kind of get a thermometer of where we are again compared to the state.
Sarah, do you have an extra copy of
Conway? Yes, I definitely do. I'll get that right up to
Can I ask, what does it mean to progress toward narrowing the proficiency gap, which is what they purport to measure?
What they're looking at is they took the high-need students, they take the special ed students, they take any of those specialized population lines, and what they want to see is they want to see the number about the same from all students to those numbers. Now, in some of these schools, you'll look and you'll say, oh, well, they are all the same number. It's actually fairly close if you look at a bunch of them. But we haven't hit the 75. So you either are level 2 because you didn't hit the 75, or there was a gap between your subgroups and your whole population. So they're looking, what they want to see is they want to see all your populations performing the same. Okay, that's the question. So if you flip over the page, you'll get some more detailed information about particular exams. So for the elementary schools, you'll see K through, no, you won't see K because K doesn't need it. You'll see 3 through 6 and the ELA math scores. And then for grade 5, you'll see science scores. At Frontier, you'll see 7 through 10. And you can just see the percent. What they're doing here is they're taking the percent of students that are proficient or higher. So any student that's proficient or advanced, that's that first column. Then you can kind of tease out advanced, proficient, and needs improvement. Now, one of the tricky pieces is only grade 10 has comparison scores, because only grade 10 students in the state all took MCAS. And so it's really hard to interpret those numbers. And what Louise and I did during our analysis is we went back and just looked historically at the elementary school grades and the middle school grades to see about how the state has been doing. And typically, it's a similar number through the year. So we did some of that analysis, too, to kind of gauge where our relative strengths and weaknesses are in curriculum. Any other general questions?
So these are just raw numbers of pupils. Those aren't percentages, right?
They're percentages, and they're, it's percent. It should be percent proficient and higher.
I'm so confused because it adds up to more.
It's proficient and higher is how many proficient and advanced. Yeah. So to get that one.
The advanced is a sub.
Yeah, the first column is a sub column, and then, yes, yeah, no, I know. Sometimes it does create numbers. So our second area of presentation tonight was professional development, just to give you an update. So last spring we handed out our fancy color charts, and we did not make additional copies of those this year for this meeting. However, if you want more, we're happy to bring them to you at the next one, because they are pretty. But some of the focus areas that we're working on are some of the things that we talked about last spring. The biggie, PK through 12, is differentiation, and we're working with Mike Anderson. Yes, there's his book, which most of the faculty have read. And so we had a couple of sessions each at the elementary and at the middle high school with him. He's an excellent national level presenter that's really brought a lot to the table around making differentiation easier for a teacher to do. Because in the old days, they used to talk about differentiation as you have 26 kids in front of you and you should have 26 lessons. Any of you who are teachers in the room know that that's impossible. And you've got to be able to clump it together. You've got to be able to bring students individual learning without the teacher doing all of the work to get that learning done. So the premise of Mike Anderson in this book is teaching kids how to make just right choices. Teaching students that they can push themselves a little bit, or they can try something that may or may not work out, and then reflecting on that choice. And so we've been doing a lot with coaching and a lot with presentation, so that's been a big push.
And the exciting thing about it is we're having students as young as kindergarten reflecting on their own learning choice and responding to teachers either say circle a smiley face if that was a good learning choice, and a sad face if it was not, and tell us why. So we're teaching students to be self-reflective about their own learning, which is going to help them in the long run. And so the super high achievers can make choices that are just right for them. They don't have to do what everybody else is doing. There are options. So that's an exciting component of this is both teaching the teachers and what we see direct impact on students immediately. They go right in and try it out. Yeah, so it's
really,
very exciting.
It's really fun, and it's fun to see it implemented in classrooms too. Second initiative, continuing on, Scott sells himself short. I mean, they have done amazing things with technology this year. I mean, we talked about our number of Chromebook requests from teachers was outnumbering our number of students in middle school. We said, oh, we need to do something different. We can't be buying more Chromebooks than we have students. And so the middle school teams and myself talked, and within 2 weeks, they rolled out a one-to-one program in the middle school. I mean, it's just an amazing feat. So we're continuing on with technology training so that teachers can learn more about what the different tools are out there in the world. At the middle and high school level, we're working on the integration of ELA and social studies writing. So those two departments are meeting all year to talk about writing in the humanities, which is an exciting project. And then we're also doing middle school math coaching with an outside presenter who's coming in and working on with the middle school teachers on coaching at the elementary level.
In the elementary level, we're working with environmental educators from the Hitchcock Center in Amherst that just built this multi-million dollar live building, green building out in Amherst. And they're coming in and training our teachers in technology engineering design, because that is an area that most elementary teachers aren't engineers. So they are coming in and training our teachers in how to provide technology engineering design projects, such as work together and design a beaver dam, and we're going to pour 2 cups of water, and it has to hold back the water, and here are your materials. So it's a lot of projects that teachers feel very comfortable with and students love. So we're having several trainings working with the Hitchcock Center this year, in addition to the Mike Anderson one. Questions?
Yeah. Yeah, I have. Is there an explanation? I'm looking at the Frontier Math numbers.
Sure, yeah.
Is there some kind of an explanation for the roller coaster ride that we've taken math from 7 to 8 to 10?
Sorry, say that one more time.
The grade 7 math,
yeah.
60% proficient. Not a great number, but at least it's 60. Then you go to grade 8, it's 46.
Right. Yeah.
Then you go to grade 10, it's 90.
Yeah. So there's a couple of reasons for that. So one, in my estimation, the grade 10 test is comparable to the grade 8 test as far as difficulty level, yet students have had 2 years more of math by the time that they take it. So we have very, very good success. We have good success even compared to the state in 10th grade math.
How do we fall from 7 to 8, from 60 to 46? What happens?
Yeah, well, the math test is a little bit more difficult in grade 8, and we're working out that. That's one of the reasons that we're having middle school math coaching. So we're bringing in outside folks to take a look at that with us so that we can make sure that our middle school math program is the strongest that it can be. So it is an area that we're looking at also.
And if I may speak to, one of the challenges with MCAS is it is not what we say is internally calibrated. In other words, it's much harder for certain grades to get to proficient than it is for other grades. Historically, statewide, fewer students statewide get proficient in some grades than others. That shouldn't be. That's why it's non-standardized. It should be consistent. If it is, if only 50% of students reach proficient as fourth graders on average, it should be about 50% sixth grade and 50%. It's all over the map. MCAS is, believe it or not, the hardest test to get proficient in is fourth grade MCAS. You have to be in the 76th percentile nationally to be a proficient fourth grader. And then it goes down in fifth. And then it goes back up in sixth. Then it goes down. It's not internally calibrated. And that's why we are administering other, what we call norm reference tests. In other words, where we get a percentile of how our students do compared to students across the nation. So we can get a picture of a student who scored these improvement as a fourth grader could be on the 70th percentile nationally with their skills. In other words, score better. And so we have brought in NWEA, which is an online test that gives us those norms, so we can do a reality check. But looking at these,
so
the test
so
is
just,
all
so just to give you a sense of it, in seventh grade, traditionally it's been about 51% of students in the state that are proficient or advanced, and we're at 61% proficient and advanced. So seventh grade is definitely in the ballpark. Eighth grade is 53% in the state, and we're 48%, and that's why we're looking at that one, because we feel that we should be at least a little bit above the state.
Are there any resources that you need to get a better handle on this to make the numbers improve?
We have just recently, actually, K through 8, changed our resource in math to be a little bit more aligned with the Common Core. So we've gone Engage New York. At the elementary level, they're using the FOSNO, which is a more of a constructivist approach to mathematics. And at the middle school, we're using some other resources that give us a constructivist piece. So I think we've done our resource change. We did that last year and actually rolling into this year.
You think
year.
It's sufficient, though?
I do. Yeah, I do. I think we have the materials that we need, and now we just need to figure out the tweaking.
Thank you.
Where do we find the percentage of students who take these tests?
As far as the state?
As far as the school, does 98% of our students
take it 100%? I think we had one student that didn't take it last year at the middle high
school. Do we lose points for that one student? We don't?
We never lose
points.
We don't. One would, but our district has very high participation.
You could lose points for participation. Our district has never been
not.
Close
okay,
to.
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
One of the numbers that you were talking about, 7th, 8th, 10th grade mathematics, how much can a change in curriculum or a difference in training affect that number? I mean, that number represents so many other different things that you have no control or ability to affect.
It's a lot. We like to think we can affect that number, but you're right. I mean, there are other variables that are really going to contribute to that whole picture. And all we can do as a school is align our curriculum as closely as we can, get our teachers the best training and coaching that we can, and then hope kids have a good day on the test, because there is some variability that you can't control for. But we really are trying to eliminate as many variables as we can, because as you say, there's a lot of factors.
Do you feel that you can move the ball or move the needle?
I do.
Okay.
I do. I feel like there's some needle movement that we have. Yeah.
And I'll bring up an example. In some of our elementary schools, in some grades, the math scores had dipped. And we looked at time on task, and we found there was a wide range of the amount of minutes students were getting in different schools at the same grade level for math. So we have had that conversation with our teachers and actually have expanded the number of minutes in several schools, because the performance wasn't where it needs to be. Quite frankly, the things that students are being held accountable for in fifth grade, in my day, was ninth grade. It's phenomenally challenging, conceptually, of what the demands are.
And
so we're doing
math homework.
Yes. Yeah. Nobody ever tried to help your children with math homework. Yes.
Yeah.
So we are fortunate. We have good support from all of you and our communities to provide professional development. And that's part of it, is if a child needs extra help, how do you provide it? If a child's got it, how do you not bore them with the same lesson? So we're doing what we can in professional development. We feel fortunate in that we have the teaching resources, the materials we need. And we just keep moving forward with a moving target. And that's why we're doing the dry run this year, to get kids accustomed to the format, so that won't be a barrier the following year. It won't be a barrier that they've never taken a test on a computer, and suddenly that interferes with them doing their best. So those are some of the things that we think about. But demographics matter.
Yeah. So so for the test this year, that's going to be this kind of combination in Cass Park. I mean, have they given you an idea like how questions are likely to be formulated and those kinds of things? I mean, because all that kind of stuff makes a difference.
There's a little bit. They do say there's going to be more writing, so that will be interesting to see how students, particularly 8-year-olds, can write an essay on a computer live online. And we know there are 3 sessions. They are untimed, so we are allotting. We are not scheduling back-to-back sessions, because even though they say they're supposedly an hour, we don't want any child to feel rushed.
Mm-hmm.
So if a class has MCAS that day, We are not scheduling another class to come in and say, give us those laptops. So we've got a challenge with that.
And they are talking about releasing questions at some point, some sample questions. We're working off the assumption that they're going to look a lot like PARC, and so we're using those as practice questions to get ready. And then if they end up being different than that, hopefully by January they'll have some samples for kids to try out.
That's the goal, is they plan to put out samples so we can begin to look at the formatting. But we do, it's a guess now. Yes.
How much are you working on keyboard?
Well,
we have software that we purchased for the schools, Keyboarding Without Tears, which is in partnership with Handwriting Without Tears.
Yeah, that's our handwriting program, is Handwriting Without Tears. So we got Keyboarding Without Tears.
And we have our educational technologist, Maureen Belche, who also works with the media specialist and helps them along through technology training in general, establishing curriculum and things that they can do when they go to the library. So it's certainly been a focus.
I have thought for years in the elementary schools it has not been stressed as much as it should be. And developing the habits in elementary school, the good habits,
right.
You know, I mean, it took me until I was in my master's program when I took a typing class and I finally like got it down versus humping tech.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time last year studying. Our media specialists studied various programs. And the nice thing about the Without Tears program is they were designed by physical therapists and OTs who, not in our district, nationally, who saw a lot of students being referred for handwriting, referred to, you know, OT or PT, and they said, whoa, let's take a look at this. So it's research-based, and but we spent, what, a year looking at programs.
So are they having time in elementary school to do it?
That's what we're starting this year. I don't know if they've begun yet,
have in the past.
Yes.
And it's more so now. In the past, we haven't had the luxury of bringing individual Chromebooks into the classrooms. We had one computer lab where there was 25 computers. The students had technology one time a week. And just trying to get all the classes into the computer lab to have enough practice time proved to be difficult. So now students, at least at the elementary schools in grades 3 through 6, were able to bring the Chromebooks into the classrooms for extra practice. So there's no tears.
Definitely. That's the goal.
Let us know if there are tears.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Maybe they give us a money back if there's tears.
Yes.
Okay, we're going to move along to the superintendent's entry plan and goals.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. If you pick up this paper that says entry plan, this is a report I wrote. This is when I was hired, I talked about an entry plan. This describes the process I'm going through as I begin my work at Frontier and Union 38. And you'll see why I'm doing it, and of course I'm proud and excited to be here, and so what I'm doing and how I'm doing it and what the goals that I have set for this plan. And it's to establish effective and productive relationships, to create a plan for the seamless transition of administrative leadership, to establish a system of clear communication, and again to develop a shared vision of Frontier Region and Union 38's strengths and areas for growth. And in conjunction with all the stakeholders, develop and implement a strategic plan for continuous school improvement. So in order to do this, I have, I have the entry plan activities, which include meeting with as many people as I can, interviewing them and talking with them and asking them questions. And they're pretty general questions. And as of the 20th, October 20th, As of September 20th, these are the people that I've spoken to and the numbers of different people. And I've kept all the data that they've given me. I've been writing it out and analyzing it, and I'm putting it in bundles of threads of information I'm getting. And I intentionally kept the questions very open and simple. And most of you have heard them. You've come to visit me. You've come to talk with me. What are the most positive attributes of Frontier Regional and 38 District? And what makes this place the great place it is? why are we all here and why are we all so happy to be here? And what are some challenges that we're currently facing? And how can we meet the needs of all our students and keep them in our schools? And that's specifically a question about how can we keep our students here from charter schools and from wanting to go somewhere else or leaving us. And so we're really going to do some studying, I think, about that and do some root cause analysis there. Communication, what's the best way for me to communicate with you? And what are your expectations for me as your superintendent, as I enter the position? What would you like to see me accomplish? And so in addition to those, I am looking at all the data that's available to us. And fortunately, I've already had experience with pretty much everything that we use. My Learning Plan, PowerSchool, ASOP, NEWA, AIMSWEB. So I also want to really focus in on our scores and use these tools that we have to really focus in on the MCAS and the NEWA. And also, too, we had some reports and audits done recently in the past couple of years. CMSI has done a report that was quite thorough, and they've offered suggestions, and they've offered recommendations to us. DESE has offered recommendations, and we've actually used a lot of those. But we're continuing to use them, and so we're drilling down and really looking at what these outside agencies are telling us. Student handbooks, our emergency management procedures, we're really taking, the administrative team and I are really working hard on the our emergency management procedures. We're really talking it over. We're meeting with the four town safety committee, and we're really, I think all the schools are done with their lockdown drills, at least one of them, with the Trooper Carmichael here. So we're working hard on that. We're also looking at walkthrough data and evaluation data. Not looking at any one particular person, but looking overall. What do we see? How are our kids engaging in their learning? When I analyze and compile this information, I am going to note emerging themes. I'm going to summarize them and make recommendations that hopefully we'll find that impact the academic, social, and emotional needs of our students and staff. It's a very, very hard job that I have. Mm-hmm. It's incredibly hard. I could say one thing, and half this room will love it, and the other half of the room will just jump up and hit the ceiling. They'll say, what? So it's a very, very tenuous position. I love it. I find that communication is really important. I really need to speak completely and thoroughly. And I like to put a lot of things in writing so that people can go back and reflect on that. So I am taking my time. I expect to come back in December with a report that really, really points out to each school committee what I'm seeing, what I'm feeling, what I'm hearing, and what do you want me to do with this? We'll work together to do it. We'll come up with some action steps. So meanwhile, this is my entry plan, and this is what I'm trying to do. These are my goals, because I have to have goals. We can't wait. I have to have goals. So these are the goals that I'm coming up with. These are different than what we'll work for on our plan together. But if you look at this sheet here, these are the goals. Goal number one, management and operations. Again, this has a lot to do with the entry plan. It's an effective entry and direction setting. By spring, I will have an understanding with you of what our most critical needs are, the goals that we'll use to, the goals and strategies that we use to address them effectively, and the measures that we're going to assess what we're doing. The benchmarks will tell you by October, right now, this is what I'm talking to you about. By December, I will come back with some more information about what I found. By March, I'll have gone enough to enough people to talk and to really understand and have some subcommittees, and I'm going to propose some key strategies. And by April, I'm going to collaborate with you. I'm going to tell you again at this meeting in April, this is what I think 3 to 5 learning and district improvement goals would be for my tenure as your superintendent for the next two years and whatever. And I want to point out that these goals are mine, but they are a team. These goals are about me and what you expect from me, but these are all done as a team. These are all done with my administrative team. These are the people that support me in what I'm doing, and I need to have my administrative team behind me to help me with all of this. So it's says it's Lynn's goals, but we're doing it together. And I'm blessed with a top-notch, excellent administrative team and teachers. So the next goal strand is instructional leadership, maintaining momentum during the transition. So we've had a wonderful, I have an excellent predecessor, Marty Barrett. She tied up a lot of loose ends for me. She put everything, you know, in its place. Now my job is to take that and move forward with that. And so I want to continue during this transition, working with the principals and the other leaders to make sure that we are making meaningful progress. And you've heard from Sarah and Louise tonight that we are, they're right on it with the education, with the academics, with the professional development. We have already had 2 or 3 meetings where we really looked at that data that you have and looked at it closely. And I've asked some really tough questions. I've gotten some really good answers. And I trust that we, as a district, we're academically, we know what we're doing. And with these people and those principals, with Sarah, Louise, and the principals, we're going to move forward. So I'm going to be working with the principals. And again, it's a team. I'll be working with Sarah. I'll be working with Louise. And I'm working with the principals on their evaluations, goal setting, self-analysis. What do they plan for their professional development? We'll have some formative evaluation conferences. I've already done this, number 3, conduct at least 3 school and classroom visits to each school. I've already done that because I can't stay out of the schools. I love them. But and then we'll have, the principals will all have their summative evaluation reports. So when we look at goal 3, that's my professional practice. Engagement in the DESE and Massachusetts Association of School Superintendents, the new superintendent induction program, which you folks have really been great by allowing me to engage in this program. It's excellent. It's wonderful. I have a coach that works with me. I'm supposed to meet with her once a month. We meet all the time. You know, she's on my fast dial whenever I need her. I do have 8 day-long sessions. I've already been to 3 where we really dig into this stuff. What does DESE expect? What are we doing? What is new coming up? What kinds of laws are we looking at? And what kinds of things are happening in other districts with other superintendents? It's a tough world out there for superintendents. It's tough. So, not for me though. I'm blessed. I'm very lucky here. But anyway, I have, so the key actions, develop strategies. I will learn so much from this. I'll complete this year. Next year I'll be in it, but it won't be as intensive. Goal number 4, again, to improve my overall professional practice as superintendent, as your superintendent of Frontier and Union 38. I will collaborate with MARS, the Massachusetts Association of Rural Superintendents. Right now, I don't know how many of you know, but Mike Bunakani from Mohawk is working on an alternative. He's made a proposal to bring to DESE for an alternative funding formula for rural schools. So in other words, if we were in a urban area, Chapter 70 works really well. Hi, Trevor. Chapter 70 works really well for people in the eastern part where there's a massive students in large schools. But for when you get the further out west, the rural schools, the funding doesn't go as far. So it's almost like one size does not fit all. So he's working on that. I am thrilled and definitely in favor of doing that and seeing what we can do to alleviate some of our fundings. I'm also engaged with the Connecticut Valley Superintendents Roundtable and the Franklin and Hampshire Superintendents Collaborative. So this collaboration really helps me bring you the best and most up-to-date learning, expectations, practices, research, right to you because I'm getting it and bringing it and passing it on. So last, my goal number five, instructional leadership, and this is, again, this is a team thing. I'm just overseeing this and working with the principals, but goal number five, goal strand, instructional leadership, very effective classroom teacher evaluation. And the goal here, principals and administrators, the district administrators, they'll be rating classroom instruction and it'll reflect a shared understanding. So we're working with the teachers to say this is what proficient looks like. This is a child that is authentically engaged as to a child who's ritually compliant and doing what we need them to do. Both children are learning, but you know, we need to grab some of those kids and really get them, you know, into it. So and again, monitor the frequency of principal visits. I meet with the principals once a month. I meet with the administrative team, everyone, once a month. And I have a cabinet I meet with once a month. And the cabinet is made up of the top directors. That's Patty, Louise, Sarah, Kim McCarthy, and Karen Ferrandino, the director of student services. So the top group meets, and then we meet with the administrative team, and that's everyone. That's director of facilities, director of technology, all the principals, assistant principals, all those people. And then again, I just meet with the principals. So we're meeting a lot. I'm visiting a lot, and again with the classrooms, I devote devote time at 5 leadership team meetings to viewing digital records of teaching. And actually Sarah Mitchell takes the lead on that because we have my learning plan where we're not looking at people, we're looking at practices, and we go in and we do quick walkthroughs, and then we take all the data we found, names not included, just the data, what kinds of practices are we seeing? How deep is the questioning? How much are we asking the kids to be critical thinkers? Are we just standing and delivering information, or are the kids constructing their own? Constructive, this means, I'm sure you all know, that they're learning, they're building their own understanding, which means that they'll internalize it better. Do they know why they're learning what they're learning? What's the purpose? And do they have ownership? And again, are they engaged? What are we asking them, those hard questions, the deep questions that really make the brain work hard, brain exercise? And what kinds of activities are they doing? Are the activities meaningful, or are they just papers and worksheets? Believe me, we don't have that here. But I will also be able to bring you data that says, hard data that proves we are doing, you know, we're teaching high quality, using high quality instructional practices here. And we're already doing it, we're going to get better. Mike Anderson's going to help us really refine and fine-tune what we're doing. But we have great teachers, and we're going to just fine-tune and open up a little bit more, because the same way with a student, you want to challenge them, you also want to challenge the teachers too. You want to say, oh, good, you really mastered that, let's try. Same thing with me. I just kept challenging myself right up to superintendent, and we just keep moving. So, and I'll be working with the principals when I go through. I really like to walk through classrooms with principals. I love walking through classrooms, and I love what I see. I see great stuff. So those are my goals for my first year. And again, they're all team goals. that administrative team down there will help me be successful in my reaching my goals. And I will be able to report to you in April on my progress in reaching these goals. Is there any questions?
Okay, so we have to take a vote.
We'll see if there are any questions first.
Well, we have to take a vote. We need motions and seconds, and then we do questions.
Will we accept the superintendent's goals?
Thank you. Second. Frontier has a motion and a second. Build it.
We have a motion to accept the superintendent's goals for the.
So moved.
Second.
I've got multiples. We're good.
Told me I had to do that.
So I'm all for just letting the superintendent take the questions. Can you on that same page?
Yes, I'm all for it.
Are there any questions? My team can help too.
They look at.
I have to really give it to the team because they've really helped me develop these. We had we just called it a little emergency meeting because it was in between our meetings. We had a meeting last Wednesday about the computers and, you know, whatever. And our PD, and they shared with me. Louise actually shared a lot with me and helped me come up with those. But they're all meaningful to me, and they're all authentic goals that I'm working on.
I only have one question. Do you have a question, Phil?
Sure.
Saw your hand go up. Go ahead first.
Just a couple things. Just your discussion about the Chapter 70 funding issue that Mohawk superintendent is pressing. I just think I would be remiss if I failed to note that our own Massachusetts Association of School Committees that we pay tens of thousands of dollars a year dues to takes a position directly adverse to that. They do recommend the one-size-fit-all Chapter 70 and just increase that one size. And that's, as I see it, that's one of the difficult things about it that we're arguing against. So hard to figure out who's really on your side.
I would go with whoever provides us with the most relief from taxes, and that's what I'm looking for.
And
I think people are starting to notice, and maybe it hasn't. I don't think that we've had a lot of. When I speak a lot, I often bring into the conversation, how much is it going to cost us? Where's the money coming from? How are we going to sustain it? Where's it going? And we do a lot of that talk, and everyone is so thoughtful. All the administrators are so thoughtful about how we spend money and what we're looking at, to the point where they're frugal. They're literally frugal. And I will tell you, one of the things I've asked going into this budget season is I've asked Bob Lesko to meet with the five principals and come up with a five-year plan of priorities so that of the facilities, so that we know going into, you know, we're going to tackle these next year, we're going to tackle these and these, because the buildings are all going on about 25 years, and, you know, we just need to start really focusing on the maintenance of it. The IT is in incredible hands with Scott. Scott can tell me anything I need to know about what the budget is, what we need here, we need this. We had a meeting, another emergency meeting with Sarah Louise and Scott and myself about, you know, how are we going to do this MCAS? We're reporting it to you, but we needed to know ahead of time, what are we going to do for MCAS 2? And again, we really are working hard. And I really want you to know that we are really thinking hard about the budget. And Patty, of course, it's constant. Tell me this. Tell me that. Where is it? And she's great because she's telling me everything I need to know.
And I guess this is addressed to you and also to Sarah and Louise, just about evaluations in general. Just, I think this is my sixth year on the school committee, and I think this is the third or fourth evaluations regimen. I understand that that's not the. My understanding is that previously that these were imposed, required, etc. it seems, reading this, there seems an elements of free will maybe in this, and that...
We're on top of the requirement. What Lynn is speaking about is our admin team also wants to collect district-wide data that isn't evaluative of teachers, but evaluative programmatically. So in other words, exactly. We will say something like, let's all look at the kinds of questioning. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Differentiated instruction.
Differentiated instruction. So we will all go through our school and just check off how many times we see it. No names involved. So it's not about the teacher. It's about how consistent programmatically are we. So that is low stakes. In other words, we don't report that to the state, but we have the conversation among ourselves to ensure that we have improved practice, continual improvement. So
right, we're looking for, and what we're doing is we're just, it's like a dipstick with the oil. We're just looking how, what kind of impact is our PD having, for instance, on the students. We're all going to go, all of us, and we're looking for the same thing. And then we're going to come back at meetings. And it says five, but we do it at every meeting. Sarah kind of leads the conversation on it. And we look at the data, and we kind of analyze. Okay, you know, 80% of the teachers are really engaging those kids in meaningful activities. Great. And then what did we see in the other 20 that we could maybe, you know, kind of help other, you know. So like a principal could say, well, the data said 80%, yay, but there are some classrooms where they're standing and talking for 40 minutes, and that's maybe too long for this age group that, you know, or this whatever, and maybe we could, you know. But it's really not about, it's not punitive or it's not evaluative that would threaten anyone's job. It's really about practice. It's like peer coaching in a way, but it's also data I can bring to you, and I can say, we've really looked at our questioning, and on the blooms, are we asking those students to engage in activities that they have to analyze, that they have to summarize and analyze? Do they really understand it? Can they compare and contrast? And that's really what we're working at. And those conversations are great at the AT meeting. Those are my favorite things that we talk about.
So is this the kind of thing that you're going to be able to do next year? Or is there a new six-letter acronym mandatory evaluation thing that's coming next year that's going to replace this?
Thank you. This is not a state mandate. As I said, Sarah actually is worked with some folks at the national level on some systems that are very efficient for us to aggregate quickly data, such as questioning, such as use of differentiation, that will help us really focus our conversations. It's not about evaluating the teacher. It's evaluating us. It's audit principles. So it's extra work for us, but we're all committed to seeing the consistency for children. When we do teacher evaluations, that's private between the principal and the teacher, and perhaps the superintendent, she can see them, but it's not a conversation we'd have at the district level. We wouldn't say, hey, how's your math teacher? We want to look at practices that are separated from evaluating a personnel, but rather, what are students going K-12 in our system getting for math education? So that's the difference.
Thanks, and that's a really great explanation. We really, there's kind of a reputation out there that Frontier is probably one of the best districts around, and there's a reason for that. And we really are not only monitoring it, but, you know, constantly finding ways to just inch it up a little bit, challenge a little bit, and that's how we really know. That's how we know that what we're teaching, what we're spending time on is actually being used. And you can see already the direct impact on students. It's amazing what we're doing. So when I talk about my goals and each teacher gets a summative and a form, that's just reassuring you that the principals are taking care of that piece and that they will have those done and that you know that we are following the mandates of the state on that piece. But that's a teacher principal kind of thing.
Thank you. Questions? You want to go first, David, and then Elaine? Go ahead. David.
Thanks. Lynn, in terms of the entry plan and the stakeholders and stuff, and I know you're doing some of this, I think I've seen you on TV meeting with Lisa Deerfield, the select board. But it seems to me if you're not doing it, it would be good to add to this list of people you've broken down, sort of the thought thinkers and the holders of the purse strings in our four various towns. So I'm just thinking of getting out there and getting to know select board members if you haven't, finance committee members if you haven't, town administrator in each town, just following up on budgetary issues and just the politics of knowing people. And
I appreciate that you said that. I have been, you know, kind of interfacing with the select boards. We've been to Waitley. I spent a nice conversation with Mr. Edwards from Waitley. I went to the Deerfield. I think it's on the 20th. In October, I think it's the 19th. Patty and I are going to Sunderland, to the Sunderland select people, and so the next stop will be Conway. But the finance committee is, I haven't really looked, and I think that's a good, that'll be done. Thank you.
Avoid saying anything about your opinion regarding ambulance service.
Hey Lynn, maybe we can get the financing committee to come to some of our meetings, our school committee meetings, just like the selectmen.
We do invite them.
We invite them a lot, and we really don't see many of the other people in town come to our meetings, so it's...
Did somebody else have...
I just, wasn't there, back to the budget, the Chapter 70, wasn't there recently a lawsuit or a finding that it was illegal the way the funding is?
I do not read that, and I was showing Bob today.
I would love to hear that.
I thought I just heard that.
I don't know, but I was showing Bob today, 50 to 60 articles twice a week, and I have not read that, but if I do, I'll bring it.
I swear I heard on the news the last couple of weeks.
Somebody Google it.
I did, and I spoke with Mike earlier this week, too, and he did not say anything.
So the only question I have is on goal number 5. I think they're really good goals. I think they're good for your first year. They might be overreaching, but good luck to you. Goal number 5, number 2 in the benchmarks, and it might need the union in on this, devote time at 5 leadership team meetings of viewing digital recordings of teaching and sharing. Is that written in the contract? How do you go about recording these teachers?
It's not our teachers.
It's not our teachers. We're YouTubing them.
Oh, well, YOUTUBE would have been a nice entry in there.
Well, and, when we also talk about digital recordings, we will talk about the numbers, so we go through with our devices, and again, we're looking at one or two things. We choose one or two things to look at. Again, what kind of questioning? Is it higher level questioning? And we don't use a teacher's name. We just put these numbers in, and then we just and that's a digital recording of a teacher observation. But it's a walkthrough. It's not.
You're not taping people.
Absolutely not. Right. No. We walk in with a device, and we just. Okay. It's a checklist, and it's on a hand device, and you just check.
Right.
How many? But then we have to go back and calibrate, because when we look at YouTube videos of teachers teaching, and every one of us sit down, and we're actually observing ourselves, and then we have to calibrate, because there's so many ways to analyze what's happening, and that's fun. That's the challenging and fun part of being a superintendent.
You can rest. You knew it was a little nervous.
No, has nothing to do with that. When we say digital recordings, it's like my learning plan. 39% of the teachers were doing A, B, or C. That's all. And that's what we're talking about.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions?
So moving along to a vote, I guess Frontier can go first. So we have the motion and we have the second. So all those in favor of approving the superintendent's goals? Opposed? It's unanimous.
And the union, we have a motion and a second. All in favor? Opposed? It is also unanimous.
Thank you.
Okay, the superintendent has said that she has included a report in her goals, so we are done with those, and we have no executive session, so Frontier needs a motion to adjourn.
Before we adjourn, can I speak, please?
Are you speaking at the Frontier meeting or at the Union 38 meeting?
As everybody in here knows that charter schools, you know, I didn't have a second education. I went into service. There's a lot more smarter people out there than myself, but reading what I've been reading about expanding charter schools and how much money that we're talking about is a lot. And I'm hoping everybody here is going to go out and vote no on charter schools, because I read every day on Facebook, I'm reading and I'm liking them and I'm sharing them with my friends, but we need all the support we can, because there's a lot of people with a lot more money than the state of Massachusetts has that are backing the opponents of this question. So
they have some good commercials about it. They're really
proponents. I think they're distorting facts.
Well, but in general, if you don't know much about it, you know, there's a lot. You know, I'm on Facebook and there's a lot about it. And most of the ones I'm reading is no on question two. I'm hoping to be at our polling place with a sign that asks everybody vote no on question two. So. I mean, that, you know, $408 million, that's what's going on right now. If we pass more charter schools, you're probably going to see double that. And then we're going to see a lot of cuts in our schools. Teachers, you name it, we could be cut. Right now we're in a, I don't know what you want to call it, black or red, when we're talking school choice money. I lose all that stuff, but it's...
Red is bad, black
yeah,
is
bad. Well, so we're in the red right now. Last year was our first year in the red because we had to pay out so much. We had a lot there. We paid out a lot more in charter schools and other things last year, so...
Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
So, again, I have a motion to adjourn for Frontier. Do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Before I pass it over to Kenny, I would like to thank our cameramen, you guys, Ben and Joe. They did a great job tonight. Thank you very much. And Kenny, it's all yours.
Do I have a motion to adjourn? The Union
so moved.
38.
Wow. Second.
Elaine, second.